In this video, we'll discuss some general considerations you may have when planning a PI system architecture. It's important to understand your options when either drawing a blueprint for a new PI system or expanding on an existing PI system infrastructure. This way, you can better compare the pros and cons of each approach and select the features that best suit the data needs of your users. There is a good amount of flexibility when it comes to planning and designing a PI system environment. For example, for data that's considered highly critical, a combination of identical PI data archives allows data to be continuously available, even in the event of one server going down. Another design consideration includes whether to place individual PI components on a single computer, or be spread apart across different machines and even in separate networks. On the other hand, be mindful to balance trade-offs when it comes to more complex architectures. A simpler one requires a minimal number of machines and people knowledgeable with its inner workings. But as the architecture gets larger, more trade-offs emerge. This could come in the form of a financial trade-off, like purchasing more computer hardware, or it could come in the form of personnel, like dedicating more human resources to help manage and support a larger PI system. The first of many architecture options is PI server high availability. We saw a diagram of this earlier in the slides. As the central storage location of time series data, the PI data archive is an essential piece in the infrastructure. The functionality of the PI system takes a huge hit when the PI data archive is unavailable. To best ensure maximum data uptime, you can take advantage of built-in high availability or HA features. Two or more PI data archives are grouped into what's called a PI collective, and each contains separate but identical copies of information. This helps to provide uninterrupted access to data. Behind the scenes, the PI collective works to sync configuration changes, and as we'll see, the primary PI data archive is in charge of this sync process. While the inner parts of a PI collective can be complex, from the user's perspective, it all resembles one logical PI data archive. One alternate approach to high availability is with the use of a firewall. Say we have a PI collective in the DMZ and many users in the corporate network. These users all need access to PI system data. If all of the PI data archives live in the DMZ, access between the corporate network and the DMZ would need to be granted through the firewall. And while this may be okay in some scenarios, imagine if a host of mission-critical servers were also within the DMZ. A lapse in security configuration may allow unauthorized users the ability to see or even change data on these servers. To remedy this, let's take one of the PI Collective members and place it in the corporate LAN. All PI client applications on the corporate LAN can be configured to connect to this PI Collective member and not the one in the DMZ. So no longer do the users need access to a sensitive network in order to retrieve PI system data. This PI data archive is still part of the PI collective, so it'll be synced with any configuration changes. We'll talk about this in a future video, but the PI interfaces are the ones responsible for sending identical sets of data to all PI collective members through a process called N-way buffering. In our setup so far, we'd have to allow multiple PI interfaces to cross the firewall to feed data to this PI data archive. But a simpler approach is to set up a PI-to-PI interface, which is a PI interface that sends data from one PI data archive to another. This greatly simplifies the diversity of traffic through the firewall. One last addition could be to add one more PI data archive on the corporate network. This, as we know, provides redundancy for the users in case one of the PI data archives in the corporate network is unavailable. Another design approach is the use of interface failover. Like PI server high availability, interface failover involves redundant copies of a PI interface run on separate computers. If only a single instance was responsible for collecting data, any maintenance or unplanned failure would stop data flow to the PI data archive. But in failover, an available interface copy is ready to take over data collection responsibilities when necessary. PI interfaces in failover accomplish this by continually monitoring the health of the other member. You can thus handle single point of failures and ultimately minimize data loss. Another consideration with PI interfaces is a feature called disconnected startup. By saving a copy of PI point configuration locally on the interface machine, interface instances can start up without a connection to the PI data archive. If the PI data archive is unavailable, the PI interface cannot be started because the interface normally needs to retrieve PI point information before starting any data collection. But disconnected startup allows the interface to bypass this restriction and provides a local copy of PI points on the interface itself. If the PI data archive is down, users won't be able to grab data, of course, but at least the interface can successfully collect and buffer data, which will be later sent to the PI data archive. When it comes to the PI system's inclusion into your network, many suitable approaches can be made. What's most common in terms of security is using the PI system with Windows Active Directory. It currently exists in many corporations and integrates especially well with the PI system's security design, most notably for configuring permissions for PI data archive resources and PI AF objects. While the PI system can recognize people by their usernames in Windows Active Directory, the PI system also needs a way to target certain machines in order to assign permissions on them. An example is a PI interface node that needs write permissions on PI points. To accomplish this, PI interface nodes needs to be given fixed IP addresses as opposed to ones handed out by DHCP servers. By attaching a fixed IP address to machines hosting PI interfaces, PI system administrators now have a means to refer to just that one computer and assign its appropriate permissions. One last note about security: network ports. For traffic flowing to the PI data archive, the single most common port you'll deal with is port 5450. This is the port that must be open on the PI data archive for any type of incoming traffic, whether it's for PI interfaces sending real-time data or users sending a request for data. For a complete list of ports for the PI system, please head over to KB01162 on our tech support site. Lastly, as is common for mission-critical server hardware, it's important to keep the server in a secured area, somewhere cool and maintained. Some considerations for this room include authenticated physical access and passwords, as well as uninterruptible power supplies. Restricting the machine from the internet is also common. Consider the pros and cons of these high-level options we've gone over to help steer the direction of your own PI system architecture planning.